I guess it's a blessing and a curse to be able to run out immediately after a talk that I hope was provocative. The subtopic of the truth discussion was defined by the organizers as, how do scientific disputes get resolved or not? What are the barriers to attaining the sort of discussion where reasonable people can understand exactly what they are disagreeing on? Well, before I begin the talk proper, I would like to comment that I had a chance to talk with Jeffrey West after disagreeing with elements of his talk yesterday. And through our discussion, I learned that we do, in fact, largely agree on those very same elements. And that is why it is imperative to agree on what it is that is disagreeable. With that lesson in mind, I call this short talk The Tyranny of Truth, and dedicated to the late Paul Feyerabend, who observed, quote, neither science nor rationality are universal measures of excellence. They are particular traditions, unaware of their historical grounding. I take that to mean that the work of science does not and cannot exist independently of the work of the rest of society, and that an historically significant barrier to scientific agreement is unconscious adherence to dogma. Innumerable books have been written on the topic of truth and the nature of scientific discourse. Max Planck, for example, was a bit of a pessimist. He said, quote, a new scientific truth does not triumph by convincing its opponents and making them see the light, but rather because its opponents eventually die and a new generation grows up that is familiar with it. Are today's science revolutionaries, and yes, that means all of us here, I'm sure, destined to become tomorrow's dogmatists? Perhaps. The first step toward becoming a dogmatist is treating an idea as true. And this is only natural. But as the philosopher Nelson Goodman observed, quote, truth, far from being a solemn and severe master, is a docile and obedient servant. The scientist who supposes that he is single-mindedly dedicated to the search for truth deceives himself. He seeks system, simplicity, scope. And when satisfied on these scores, he tailors truth to fit. He as much decrees as he discovers the laws he sets forth, as much designs as discerns the patterns he delineates. Decades ago, the philosopher of science, Philip Frank, commented on the battle between competing scientific models. Quote, why do philosophers and scientists so often disagree about the merit of a new theory? They mostly disagree because the new theory seems to be in contradiction to established philosophical principles. Moreover, this disagreement arises from necessity, for the established philosophical principles are mostly petrifications of physical theories that are no longer appropriate to embrace the facts of our actual physical experience. History does indeed show that the superseding of proven scientific ideas by new and improved scientific ideas tends to be resisted by those who have made a career out of successfully using the old ideas, which, after being proven, are known as common sense. Typical dogmatists wave the standard of common sense as an argument against evidence-based reasoning that contradicts it. Fortunately, science is self-correcting, because a new idea, such as Darwinian evolution or the atomic theory of matter, requires adequate empirical support and predictive power before it is allowed by the scientific community to replace the old models. So dogmatism is at once an obstacle and a test. Famously, the Vatican resisted Copernicus' theory that the sun was the center of our solar system. But as Feyerabend pointed out, the Ptolemaic Earth-centered model of the universe that dominated science until the 15th century was perfectly in accord with scientific observation. When the upstart Copernicus came along with a better idea, if not better raw data, he was met with resistance by the ruling intellectual power, the Catholic Church, which had many theological, political, and scientific reasons to suppress this theory. A century or so passed before Copernicus' basic idea was awarded the crown of common sense. And the simple truth that our solar system is heliocentric is not likely to fail. In fact, many basic scientific truths survive incorporation into more comprehensive explanations of what is. In physics, Newton's classical mechanics became gospel after data confirmed its truth, and Einstein's explanation of gravity as a function of a curved space-time became canon after confirmation by celestial data. But then, with the advent of quantum mechanics, the tables turned, and the cascade of wonderfully accurate atomic data went begging for theoretical explanation. Oddly, the lack of the existence of a believable interpretation for quantum mechanics became enshrined as dogma when Niels Bohr declared that we cannot speak about what goes on inside the quantum realm. Despite the skepticism of Einstein and others of lesser voice, Bohr's view went largely uncontested. And by the early 1950s, it was practically career suicide for a young physicist to question the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics, or von Neumann's nonlinear postulate of wave function collapse. But in 1957, a young graduate student named Hugh Everett challenged the ideological status quo with the linear logic of a non-collapsing wave function. The mathematical and philosophical audacity of Everett's many-worlds theory helped to break up a theoretical logjam in quantum physics. But this did not mean, as Everett himself stated, that Bohr's considerable contributions to physics were wrong. The problem was sociological. Bohr's originally open-minded scientific spirit had become petrified with success, and his career-oriented followers cast Bohr as the eternal revolutionary with the inside scoop on truth. Remarkably, Bohr's inner circle accused Everett of being a metaphysician when it was they themselves who could not see even potential merit in any scientific theory that challenged Bohr's no-go edict, which was itself metaphysical. Frank points out, quote, "A great many metaphysical systems are merely abandoned systems of science. No doubt the same fate awaits the proudest achievements of today's science. And is that fate a bad thing? I think not. It merely puts our humanity in perspective and encourages us to acknowledge the existence of our own ideological biases and special interests. Even our best theories are not candidates for eternal verities, but they are expressions of our personal passions and ideologies, and of that we should be proud, while not hiding behind a claim to be ideologically sterile. It's only by admitting our prejudices that we stand a chance of curing them." This wonderfully eclectic, passionate, cross-pollinating FQXi conference has cruised through metastable landscapes of string theory and fitness landscapes of E. coli cells and produce many interesting debates among those who seek to improve on the scientific status quo. Some improvements require making increasingly reliable interpretations of behavioral and brainwave data. Some are theoretical extrapolations, eager to mate with data correspondent to phenomena that interact somewhere beyond the range of modern scientific instruments. And interestingly, the seemingly ordinary phenomena which we gathered here to discuss, time, turns out to be rather slippery. Some say time is a macrophysical form of adaptive selection. Some say it is a mathematical abstraction. Some say it has no arrow. Some say that the arrow of time is multidirectional. Some say time is a function of mental perception. Some say it has been irreversibly inscribed in a block universe. And in philosophical defense of their ideas, some evoke the idealism of Plato, others the empiricism of Mach. But regardless of the particulars of these many disagreements, one thing we all do have in common is that one day, all of today's bright ideas will be history. And in that light, I conclude with a few more words from Philip Frank. Quote, "It is not to be denied that the philosophy of enlightenment possesses a tragic feature. It destroys the old systems of concepts, but while it is constructing a new system, it is already laying the foundations for new misuse. The creative forces must of necessity create perishable buds. They are destroyed in the human consciousness by forces which are themselves marked for destruction. And yet, it is this restless spirit of enlightenment that keeps science from petrifying into new scholasticism." Nietzsche, said Frank, comes out in defense of the cause of enlightenment against the self-satisfied possessor of an enduring truth. Nietzsche said, quote, "The assertion that the truth is here and that an end has been made of ignorance and error is one of the greatest seductions. Assuming that one believes this, then the will to test, investigate, predict, experiment is crippled. The truth is consequently more ominous than error and ignorance because it binds the forces with which one can work for enlightenment and knowledge." End quote. In sum, and this is a quote from an anonymous philosopher, "It is not what people do not know that is most dangerous, it is what they think they know." And now, hopefully, Victoria Stodden will talk about how we might be able to start fixing this problem.